Here.
Mrs. DiNallo?
Here.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Here.
Mr. Augustine?
Here.
Mr. Fodor?
Present.
Mr. Hack?
Here. Can I have a motion to approve the agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as submitted. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
That's carried. Can I have an invocation will be given by Nick Augustine, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
Heavenly One, we are fortunate to live in a place of freedom and plenty, and we thank you for those gifts. As we conduct our business tonight, may we remember that we are to be responsible stewards of these gifts for the benefit of those who have trusted us with these positions of leadership. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNallo?
Yes.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. This is our public comment from visitors. We will now recognize visitors. Please raise your hand if you wish to speak. When called upon, please use the podium. Clearly state your name and address into the microphone and limit your comments to 3 minutes. Any dialogue must be conducted through me as president of council. Although your comments, questions, and the address of the council administration of both. Anyone would like to speak on this side? This side? All right, we have no committee reports. On legislation, if you wish to comment on legislation, you must request to do so at this time. Those making such a request then will be called upon after the reading. Any dialogue must be conducted through me as president of council. Although your comments or questions can be addressed to the council administration of both. When called upon, please use the podium. Remember, clearly state your name and address into the microphone and limit your comments to 3 minutes. Anyone like to speak on ordinance number one? Ordinance number two? Ordinance number three? Resolution number four? Okay, we'll move into ordinance number one, first reading.
An ordinance to make appropriations for the current expenses and expenditures of the City of Painesville, State of Ohio for the fiscal year beginning January 1st, 2019 and adopting the operating budget and declaring an emergency.
Okay, this is the 29 budget. We already gave you guys a presentation. We are going to do a quick overview of it again. Joe, you get to sit through the 2 hours you missed it, so. I know you missed the presentation.
Sorry. There we go.
Okay, total budget and revenues for 2019 is going to be just over $77 million. This is an increase of almost $7 million from 2018. Our intergovernmental revenues will be going up. We did a great job getting grants. Our user fees are going up. That's like our water, sewer, electric revenues. Those will be going up. And then there'll be a transfer in. Those are going up by almost $3 million. We're transferring money from our electric reserve fund into the electric construction fund to pay for capital. I know it was quick, but if you guys have any questions, we already gone over this quite a bit, so feel free to jump in or.
Yes, questions or comments?
Well, sorry. That one more. Okay. This is the total budgeted expenses for 2019. We expect the total budget to be just over $84 million. This is an increase of $5.6 million from 2018. Some of our bigger expenses are for personnel services, which is about $29 million. Our utilities, which is our purchase power, which is going to cost $17 million. Our operating transfers out, we're going to cost about $4 million. And our total capital for 2019 is just under $19.6 million. The 2019 general fund will have a budget deficit. All the main funds will need to use carryover monies to balance. In the main funds, the majority of the expenses are for personnel expenses. We are proposing $19.6 million in capital projects. This is $200,000 less than we did in 2018, but we're still spending a good amount of money on capital. We are putting a lot of money towards paving roads, repairing sidewalks, continuation of the water intake, and placing electric wires underground for the future development of the High Point Center. This shows our expenses by fund group. Our largest source of expenses is our proprietary funds. This is our water, sewer, and electric funds. They account for 68% of the 2019 budget. The general fund accounts for the second largest portion of our expenses at 16%. And then the special revenues account for 9% of the budgeted expenses in 2019. This slide shows where our expenses go. The city's largest source of expense in 2019 will be for salaries. This will be slightly over $29 million in 2019. This is salaries and benefits. Capital outlay is our second largest expense, and our utilities is the city's third largest expense. The general fund specifically will have budgeted revenues of just under $12,800,000, and we'll have expenses of just under $13 million. We'll have a budget deficit of $193,000 in the general fund. The general fund revenues are increasing by 2% in 2019. This is our interest revenues will be going up in 2019. Our expenses are going up by about 3%, and these are operating expenses going up and the wages going up as well. The general fund will have to transfer $290,000 into the cemeteries fund, so that fund can remain solvent. These are the general fund revenues. The largest source of general fund revenues are the taxes. This accounts for $9.6 million. The second largest source of revenues in the general fund is the fines and forfeitures. This is court monies and accounts for about $1 million. And then the third largest source of revenues are miscellaneous revenues, and these are mostly our interest incomes, and that accounts for about $700,000. This is a breakdown of the general fund. 2015 through 2017 is actual revenues and expenses. 2018 and 2019 are budgeted revenues and expenses for the general fund. The revenues are the red lines and the expenses are the yellow lines. The general fund, most of the general fund's expenses go towards salaries and benefits. This will account for 81% of the general fund budget. We also have costs such as dispatch, which is going to be $553,000 in 2019. Payments to the health district, payments to the DPO, payments for the Reading Income Tax Agency collections, and the city's liability insurance. This is a breakout of the city's personnel departments. You will see the total community development employees, one from 12 employees to 13 employees. The additional employee is for the new employee to oversee the sidewalk replacement program. And the electric department, they're decreased two employees. Those are two employees at the plant that we have eliminated through attrition. This is breakdown of the general fund expenditures by department. The largest general fund expense is the police, which is about $4.5 million. The second largest general fund expense is the fire, which is $2.6 million. Our third largest expense is the non-departmental, that's $2.5 million. This is our hospitalization cost, which is $1.7 million, our workers' comp costs, and our transfers out. And then the fourth largest expense in the general fund is the courts, and that is $1.1 million. And that is a quick overview of the 2019 budget. We'll do the utilities and capital at the next council meeting.
Any questions or comments? Thank you.
And council does have three reads for the budget. Thank you.
We'll leave this on the first reading. Ordinance number two, first reading.
An ordinance approving a settlement agreement to resolve legal issues, approve a development plan, change the zoning of parcels of property, and grant variances in order to settle litigation and facilitate the development of parcels numbers 35A001. 000010 15C036H000310 also 35A001000040 35A001000110 35A001000150 owned by Encore Development and declaring an emergency.
Yes, great. Sterling, would you like to speak?
I thought we were here. Oh, I thought we were here. Here's Jordan.
It's up to you. There are several pieces to the overall settlement that occurred on these five parcels. Everyone party to this agreement worked with the court for the last 10 plus months to try to find a reasonable solution to all the concerns. As with all settlements, every party makes concessions. Tonight, we are talking about the concessions made by the city and the benefits that come from those concessions. The city started the settlement conversation several months ago when we were brought into the dispute as a result of title agency challenging our assessments on the Lime Cove properties. What started as a potential lawsuit between the title agency and the city ended with a settlement agreement with the title agency, the county treasurer, a developer for the site, a developer for the neighboring site, a realtor, and a resolution to a lawsuit pending in the 6th District Court of Appeals. Each one of these pieces has its own settlement piece in the overall puzzle, and tonight we are going to talk about our piece of the settlement. The entry and order related to conveyance of real property free and clear of liens is on the agenda for council's approval. I understand this document in isolation may seem hasty. So let's start by saying, although there were time constraints on all parties to come to a negotiated deal, hundreds of work hours were used to analyze the agreement to come to the best conclusion possible for the city. Nothing was entered into lightly. Throughout the settlement proceedings, we used every resource available to analyze the pros and cons of the overall agreement. Our concessions for the agreement are tied to zoning and variances needed for the residential and commercial development under the new owner, Encore Development LLC. As you know, the court has ultimate authority for zoning and variances. Although this will not go in front of planning or BZA in the public meeting if approved by council tonight, the court has already determined it is in the best interest of all parties per the agreement and entry. This is stated on page 2 and 3 of the agreement. The court further finds that this agreement and entry are necessary and appropriate in lieu of the processes of the planning of the Painesville City Planning Commission and the Painesville City Board of Zoning Appeals for the variances that are listed above under the circumstances, and that due weight and consideration of these items was given by the City of Painesville and by this court in approving this entry. The development itself does not stray too far from a development proposal that was brought before the Planning Commission previously. The similar development was approved by the Planning Commission on 2 separate occasions. Therefore, there was no indication that this particular development would be turned down. The major differences in the addition is the addition of a multifamily piece that is slated for market rate senior independent housing. As stated, this is market rate housing for our senior population. The developer, Clover Development, is in the audience and can answer questions of council later. The density and square footage variances that are in the agreement are not out of line with other apartment buildings in town. You will see that there is more square foot per unit on this development than any other comparable, and less units per acre. This includes the residence on the avenue that was just approved by both planning and BZA. Some may wonder what the alternative to these zoning variances may have been. There was one alternative presented to us. In the agreed entry, page 1, it discusses a payment of $125,000. As you can see, this $125,000 was used to settle a claim under a separate lawsuit that was at the 6th District Court of Appeals. This court case pertained to the wetland mitigation permit tied to Lime Co development site in order to fulfill its off-site mitigation obligations. Without this mitigation permit, no or very little development could move forward. To oversimplify the information or the situation, the city was left with 2 decisions. One, allow zoning and variances, which the court already agreed was in the best interest of the community under these circumstances. Or 2, pay for a wetlands mitigation permit on a separate lawsuit in order to make sure this property could be developed in the future. Neither one of these choices is ideal. We all agree that development is in the best interest of the community. So as part of the settlement, we felt we could negotiate some extra benefits tied to the zoning and variances agreement. So that is the direction we took. As you will see in Exhibit B, the staff, normally involved in a site review process, did review the plans associated with Encore Estates. This review is 13 pages long. The concerns and directions given from the departments were discussed with the developer, and Encore Development will be remedying the concerns at their own cost. Some highlights of the agreement. Elizabeth Boulevard has been a safety service concern, for the city for a long time, which will be addressed at the cost of the developer. The development cannot move forward without the road being put in. There will also be some looping of roads between Heisley and Encore to provide better traffic flow. The developer agreed to widen Elizabeth Boulevard to 36 feet in width and install a left turn lane on Elizabeth where it intersects with Shamrock Boulevard. This exceeds our current code requirements. There's also fire and police. They agreed to all the amendments on the fire, and they will be doing a traffic study on the police when we say that it's necessary. Under each of the utility upgrades, Encore Development is going to pay for their portion of all the upgrades on the systems, including potential upgrades to our pump station needed on the sewer side and some extra water infrastructure. They're also giving us right-of-way and land use for the Jackson Street relocation tied to the interchange, And they also agreed to withhold building on a couple of lots in case it affects the interchange project. And there's also a hydrology study that will have to be done to prove that the housing development can go in. Asking that all of the improvements necessary under Exhibit B are done at the cost of the developer, widening Elizabeth Boulevard that exceeds our code minimum, and adding a turn lane from Elizabeth onto Shamrock are all extra benefits of the city. Settlements are about concessions. The city worked diligently to make sure we did not concede more than we benefited from this agreement. Staff worked tirelessly with the counterparties to provide the best settlement agreement allowable under the circumstances, and the court has agreed. Now, we recommend the council move forward with the approval of this legislation.
Great. Ray Starnot, 346 Birchwood, Painesville. Bear with me, Mr. President. I am both in support and opposed to this project as it appears before this body for review and approval this evening. As a Painesville resident who lives in Heisley Park, I am personally very much in support of developing this property. It will allow a second way to enter and exit Heisley Park other than from Jackson and Elizabeth. I'm pleased the city will be getting tax revenue. These are all very good points for passing this project. However, as a member of the Planning Commission and former process manager, I find I cannot support this ordinance from a process viewpoint. This is the first time we've officially heard about this development of proposed changes in zoning. Specifically, the zoning change that being approved this evening did not go through the Planning Commission for consideration and review. I fear that this action may allow a precedent in the future to bypass the Planning Commission process in its entirety. Additional concern that I have as a commission member is exactly what is being proposed. It has yet to have public scrutiny. Additional points that I believe may have possibly come up in a planning commission meeting established for reviewing new developments are: council suggested increased setback and parking requirements, buffering from trains requirement, stormwater systems being separate from Harsley Park and maintained by the separate HOA, wider roads, especially major arteries such as the Cherrywood Extension, better placement of fire plugs, separate entrances for safety, and given comments by and a poll by HP residents, a need review of the Jackson Elizabeth Road exit due to additional road traffic that additional houses and traffic cutting through the Jackson onto Elizabeth would bring, making it more difficult for Heisley Park residents to access Elizabeth. A road bond guaranteed by the builder during any construction period, a separate construction road while construction is active, requirements that backup sump pumps or an optional water backup be required as part of the building's plans based on what was experienced in Heisley Park, a geological study to prevent homeowner sump pumps from pumping underground water instead of just pumping rainwater away from foundations, including the installation of French drains as necessary. The finishing top coat done on roads in a timely manner. Drainage reviewed so that the added loss of green space does not cause underground water or surface water into other neighborhood adjacent streets. And if occurring, placing French drains, as was done in Heisley Park by the builder developer, to divert water away from affected properties of and this new development. Thank you.
Questions or concerns from the council?
Yes.
So I'm going to vote first. President and acting rest of the council, thank you for your time tonight. My name is George Davis. I'm the president of Proville Homes and also the owner of Encore Development, local builder and developer. I just wanted to explain to you why we're here tonight. As Monica Ireland expressed, this was part of a long legal settlement. My part in that was, as the potential purchaser is, we have these two looming dates. This is a property coming out of a very complicated bankruptcy. It's been tied up for years and years because of that, and a very complicated wetlands lawsuit, both of which had deadlines in November.
and everyone was at impasse, right? So I offered to pay for the taxes in exchange for speeding up the process. And I just wanted to explain to you why I did that. It wasn't to circumvent the city. I'm a local guy. I don't want residents coming to my house or coming to my place of business. I'm a good developer. It was about timing. So we are, I don't want to say the 11th hour, but we're like at 9 p.m. in an economic expand, in an economic cycle of a positive. So it's pretty widely accepted among builders and developers that that economic cycle is going to slow down in the summer of 2020. Speeding up this process allows Ryan Holmes, who's the contractor that will be building Encore Estates, who also built Heisley Park, it allows them to get momentum before this slowdown. Heisley Park was successful in the slowdown because they had momentum going into it. So primarily, that was my reasoning for asking to speed up the process, not to circumvent the city. I worked hand in hand with many members of the city staff to address all those concerns that Monica eloquated in many, many edition. We did hydrology, we do have French drains. We have rear yard drains on all of them, and the yard drains below basement depth. So we are aware, I'm using the same excavating contractor that did Heisley Park, spent a lot of time and money to make sure that we didn't create more problems. So, I know I'm asking for you to speed up the process, but I just wanted to explain to you what my thought process was on that. And then I wanted to, just mention that, and I think everyone's aware, but letting this project start will fund the TIF that will help to make Jackson Street a reality. If that wetlands lawsuit didn't get settled, this property has zero value. Nobody will develop it. It's too expensive today to buy those wetland credits. So I think I made the right decision in offering to do that to help benefit the city. I want to be a good partner to the city. I don't know if everybody's aware, but I offered to try to help mitigate the whole mentor issue. So myself and Lance Osborne and Joe Zeman from Mentor, we sat down last week. I truly believe that seeing that whole area develop does nothing but help the city. And if what I do helps and I can help make that all happen, I want to do that. Longtime resident of Lake County here. So I just wanted to explain that. And then lastly, I wanted to say that, I think that we're doing Elizabeth as phase one, because I mean, that is a problem for 600 residents to have all access on Jackson Street. So phase one is the extension of Elizabeth. And, Ryan Holmes is gonna be starting their models on two lots on the existing Elizabeth so that they can have a good number of pre-sales. They'll be starting their models while we're doing our improvements. On the R2 piece proposed selling to Clover Independent Living Facility, I just want to let you know that I had multiple potential partners for that piece. I chose Clover because they do a quality market rate product. They have a great reputation. It's a proven product. They have one in Willoughby Hills that I just learned tonight is 98% occupied. I toured that early on before I got into negotiations with them because I want to be a good partner for the city. And so I did put a lot of effort in selecting Clover, and I think they would be a good benefit to the city. When I notified Ryan Holmes about that, they were ecstatic. They feel that it's a great benefit to all residents to have a place for their grandparents or older relatives to live. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Robert Jack from Clover, who's here to further discuss those his
problem.
Yeah, George Davis, 7962 Butler Hill Drive, Concord Township, Ohio. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Rob Jack with Clover Development. First of all, thank you for your time this evening. Appreciate you guys taking time to hear this. And George mentioned we're interested in purchasing about seven and a half acres. To build 119 market rate senior independent living residences. Our facility allows seniors to age in place and kind of remain in the same community they've been in, go to church, the same church, same doctors, same retail. As George mentioned, we pay full taxes, we're not subsidized in any way, shape, or form. Our units are market not income restricted. We have about 7 of these operating in Cleveland, greater Cleveland area, including Goldie Hills, as you mentioned. We're also at Parma, Strongsville, Reminderville, Medina. We have one under construction in in Homestead Falls, and looking at a new location in the city of Logan. So we develop these, we build these, and then we operate these. We don't put out of them long-term players in the community. We have about 30 operating units in New York, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Indiana, and Kentucky. And so if there's, I guess if there's any questions specific to our development, I'd like to know.
Yes.
So when I'm looking at the documentation that Monica did send to us, I noticed that your pamphlet or flyer talks about a 1-bedroom square footage and a 2-bedroom square footage.
Yeah.
And I know there's only going to be 4 of the single bedrooms, but why did we choose to go from 625 down to 590? That was just it kind of bothered me, and I was curious.
Yeah, as our buildings evolve, I guess, we get feedback from the residents. As mechanical systems change, get a little more efficient, we don't need to be quite as big. Generally speaking, our residents prefer kind of a smaller unit to maintain and take care of. And as you mentioned, there is only 4 units of that size.
So the units that you're building elsewhere are going to be
590? Yes, that's
they
the
are
perfect.
590
yes,
as well. So this
yes.
is not unique to us.
Oh, no.
That was my question.
Yes. Oh, yeah. That's great.
Any other questions? Oh, thank you. Oh, your address.
Oh, I'm sorry. 348 Harris Hill Road, Williamsville, New York, 14221. Yeah.
Discussion or comments from the council?
Paul, I would just like to comment. You know, I understand why sometimes ordinances and resolutions and things like that that come before council seem as though they're rushed or they're hurried. I think it's an underestimation to say that this discussion about these properties have come before us in executive session at least 10 times prior to now. And that, you know, the administration has done an excellent job of keeping us in a constant loop and being completely aware of what our options were. I speak for myself when I say, is this the ideal ending for the situation? I don't feel that it is, but we're at the point that, as Monica said, or actually I think it was one of the developers had said, you know, we would either go this direction or have a massive piece of property that wasn't developed or able to be developed in the future. I felt that this was something we needed to do. This is a piece of property that's sat vacant for I don't even know how many years now, and we put millions of dollars into a bridge for the sole purpose of developing the property. So hopefully everybody can understand, and hopefully all the things that are being said actually come to fruition the way they should.
I think the answer to another question is that you know, council does not take lightly the changing of the policies and procedures that are put in place, the Board of Zoning Appeals and the Planning Commission. They do a valuable service. Mm-hmm. And this is a unique situation in that there's lawsuits, the courts are involved, there's already a judgment signed by a judge. It's not your typical planning development of living facilities. And we've had multiple conversations through council that we want to make sure that the integrity of the Board of Zoning Appeals and the Planning Commission, that the residents realize that we as council people believe in that. And this is a very unique situation, one of those 500-year storms or something like that. Of course, we're having those more often these years. So that has been weighing on our minds quite a bit as well.
I would also like to comment that I do think the project is a good project. I do appreciate all the hard work that has gone into this. I also appreciate the voice that I've heard from members of the Board of Zoning Appeals and the Planning Commission, and would share that I would have, as a council member, preferred that the city settle the wetland litigation itself and not waive the or bypass those two boards, but I was not of the majority of council on that opinion. I am depending on the developer to be a good neighbor, as he has indicated tonight. I'm also depending on our city officials to provide adequate oversight, and would share that the documentation I've seen thus far from Ms. Ireland has confirmed that I can count on our department heads and our leadership to really provide that adequate oversight.
Ms. Chu.
There's one other thing that I would actually like to address. I think it has been mentioned that this is a slippery slope. If we start this, then another developer could come in and use this as, I'll say the word precedent, but it's probably not the legal term. But I have talked with Ms. Ireland, and this situation is a conflict with so many different pieces, parts that are always moving in. To have the exact same type of pieces, parts to move again, to have another developer to be able to do, to ask for this type of thing simply because he wants it or she wants it, Monica assures me that will, her words were, never happen. So I'm confident in her that, and confident in the situation that this is not going to be the regular way things happen. So I'm confident in that as well.
Well, I think that refers right back to us, that we as council people have that organizational memory that we don't forget as well. You know, the other aspect of when you build a living facility like this is density is one, square footage of the individual units, and then also parking. One of the pieces of information that we were given is that several different communities and location of facilities, as well as the number of occupants. In Tonawanda, New York, there's 170 occupants, there's 155 parking spots, but only 119 people have cars. In Syracuse, there's 144 and 92 people have cars. So one of the problems, I know that if you talk with any of the council people that we deal with on a daily, maybe not daily, on a regular basis, so is parking in our neighborhoods and living areas. That density is always an issue. But when I attended the Council on Aging, had a conference 2 months ago, I think it was by now, one of the things that they talked about was one, the ability for seniors to get around with the not driving. And the other part of it was socialization. Well, if you take a look at the, and I'm sure there's a few of these, and if not, you can see mine, the areas that are associated with these facilities ask for socialization, for workout rooms, the places to sit and socialize by fireplaces, things of that nature. You know, it's looking a little bit like Norman Rockwell. So the 1,000 square feet that you have for a two-bedroom, and these are at 750, that 250 square feet, I kind of get, is more of a social group. And when you have 119 units, and you could have 150 or 170 people there, you're hoping that one of the things they're looking for at this age group, and a few of us are starting to knock on that door, you're starting to look for an easy way for that socialization. Maybe
now
you can't get up to the Y or something like that, but you can just, you know, walk down the hall or walk outside and 50 feet away. So it's different than what we've had in the past of, I have my 1,000 square feet, and this is my territory, and you can, you know, I don't venture beyond that. But I think in this day and age, with the senior baby boomers in 2030 going to be at least 20% of our population we need housing for this group. And I guess that's my final, unless something else comes to mind.
Nobody else has to talk about mine. Anyone else like to comment?
Move to suspend.
Second.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Denial?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
No.
Motion to approve?
Second.
Adopt.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Denial?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
No.
I.
Oh, did I? I'm sorry, Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Ordinance number two approved. Ordinance number three, first reading.
An ordinance amending section 167.071 of the Paintsville Code of 1998 relating to the classification and compensation plan and declaring an emergency.
Okay, this is the resolution for the ordinance for the raises for the IBEW group, which is our electric workers. This is the same contract that has been approved by council already. It's a 3% increase since 2018, a 2.5% increase since 2019, and a 2.5% increase in 2020. We've had executive session to discuss this, and we are asking that you waive that all three reads be suspended.
Move to suspend.
Second.
Mr. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Denial?
Yes.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes.
Second.
Who moved to adopt?
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Denial?
Yes.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Ordinance number three passed. Resolution number four, third reading.
A resolution implementing sections 3735.65 through 3735.70 of the Ohio Revised Code, establishing and describing the boundaries of a community reinvestment area, CRA number 5, in the city of Paintsville.
Thank you. This stands the third reading for the proposed new CRA area number 5, which, if approved, will provide an economic development opportunity for granting real property tax abatement and increased property valuation resulting from new construction or remodeling of existing structures as defined within the residence within the legislation for residential, commercial, or industrial facilities. There are two minor changes that need to be made to the legislation that are noted in your packet in the legislation, which include the exclusion of two parcels that were previously noted in the CRA area. The first change is a very small parcel right there, a budding recreation park. The other is an area as an off-ramp area that was identified off of State Route 2, and both were previously noted in other CRA areas. So again, both of these are minor changes, were to exclude those parcels that were depicted in the previous CRA districts to avoid duplication. Other than that, everything remains the same.
Do we need to make a motion to amend the, then I would like to make a motion to amend the ordinance as written, given the recommendations of our economic development.
Second.
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Donato?
Yes.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. No, we have an amendment. We can vote on it.
Yes.
Move to adopt.
Second. Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Donato?
Yes.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Resolution number 4 passed. Move into unfinished business. We have none. New business. We have strategic plan goal number 2 update.
So as council knows, throughout the year we've been, the staff has been working on your strategic plan implementation. One item that needs to come back to council to at least discuss is under goal number 2, which is strengthening community communications and engagement. We had talked about an ambassadorship program, and the group that takes care of this, which I'm not in, so I'm going to speak as intelligently as I can on it, came up with guidelines, purpose, procedure, and audiences for our ambassadorship program. The staff is pretty adamant that although a staff member should be on this, we would also love to have a council member as an ambassador to work alongside of us. So the ambassador program encourages city council members to serve as liaisons to the community and as the initial contact person for different audiences within the city. So key city staff members will work collaboratively with council members representing the city of Gainesville's voice on important topics and issues. Each council member's audience is chosen based on the best fit for their background and previous experience. So the procedure is to allow the city's representative to be the face of different audiences, to represent the city as an elected official at meetings, gatherings, and social engagements, listen and grasp a group's concerns or feedback, report back to city council on the group's feedback, and continue communication with the audience in collaboration with staff. So we felt the best audiences are on the left. The council member we felt had the most experience in each of these areas is under council member, and then the staff member that would be alongside throughout the ambassadorship program. So I had shown this to Christine, to go over, and she felt it was best if we brought it back to council as a whole so that council members can comment on whether they like the audience that they're tied to, if they felt someone would be better in their place, and then try to answer any questions that might be tied to this.
My first question is, why is Andy Bubnetic not on there?
Do you really have to ask the question?
Well, I mean, you can give it. You can take it. I'm good with this. My only question would be, there's a couple of us that stand out that I understand the placing them where their skills are best suited. Mm-hmm. But is there a chance in those roles there could be conflicts that are going to come up for them? Does that make sense? So I mean, like, for me working with nonprofits, being a council person working for a nonprofit, for Nick being a business person, mm-hmm. being a council person working with the businesses, it's kind of like a, not a slippery slope, but there's just areas where it could end up being conflicts. Was there a discussion surrounding that?
So under the code of conduct, in this role, the ambassador represents the city first, city council second, and their interests third.
Okay.
So that's the bottom line in the sand, is that when you're in this role, it should be the best interest of the city first in that role.
Okay. All right. So it was, the topic did come up.
Yeah, we thought about it.
Okay. That's what I just wanted to make sure of that.
Great. Any other comments?
Well, I think it's a great idea, and I think it's important that we participate in this, and I guess my only one question would be, so the council member would be giving direction as far as what's coming up and where they need to be from the staff member?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Yeah. So not, these wouldn't be necessarily like monthly or weekly meetings. It would be maybe to begin quarterly just to build that relationship, and then when things arise, that group would then know who the best person to contact the council was, so that you guys are far more engaged in things that are going on in the community.
And then one other question I have is as far as backup would go. So let's just say something was going on with the school and you didn't go. Would there be any need for, you know, council members to cover for one another? And should there be a second tier of response? You know, a second person who could respond if that person can't go. So like Jim's out of town. Does nobody go? Or does somebody go in Jim's place?
I would guess at that point you'd probably reach out to the council president and ask who they felt the backup should be.
Would there be benefit to designating that person ahead of time?
That's up to you guys.
It could be up to town too.
Well, the only reason I'm thinking is that they could be in communication and kept up, so you know, kind of abreast of things, so that they're not going in blind or something. That would be one advantage. I think you did that on the senior.
I mean, tomorrow, just send me an email if there's a if there's something that interests you as a backup, and then we can put it on that spreadsheet.
I mean, if the other council members are thinking
about it. I do think it's good. I'm not sure that we need to make it such a formal process, because as Tom said, you know, I could say, gee, I can't go, and I could ask him, and he's not there. So I think at that point, it would just be the role of some, either the staff member or the council president, is trying to find someone to attend if it's super critical. And the staff member would probably be the one that would say whether it's an absolute must or not, I would think. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing that I want to make notice of, do you notice that I have no skills?
Oh, so well,
your skills are
not. I was going to go like this, though. I wasn't going to go like this.
Okay, surrounding area and master, that means.
No, look at it this way. You just encompass everything.
Right.
Jet, you're on the JET board, so that's the surrounding area. I didn't see the rationale for that.
Well, you don't know me either.
If you want to, just email me if there's something else that you want to be a second part to. So we can write that down. Anything else for this? Mark, tonight we have a department presentation by our finance.
Do it again.
That's what I was hoping for, Andy. You could do it one more time. That's why Randy left.
Yeah.
Law director. City manager.
I was asked to remind residents to, if they would like, to mark the edge of the sidewalk in their front yard, so as no sidewalk plows come through, we're not ripping your front yard up. That is one thing that, whether we want to admit it or not, snow is coming, so put the stakes up on your yard so we don't mark up your front yard. That's all.
Thank you. Correspondence, clerk of council.
The next regular council meeting will be held on Monday, December 3rd, 2018 at 7:30 p.m. City Hall will be closed November 22nd for Thanksgiving Day. The Painesville Tour of Homes is December 2nd from 1 to 4 p.m. The Christmas Vespers concert at Lake Erie College is December 2nd from 4:30 to 7. And Pride Articles, the deadline is Friday, December 7th for the 2019 edition.
Do you have any more information on the tour of homes? I've heard about it. I just don't know. Is it a DPO?
Yes, DPO.
Okay, so I guess if you guys want to go on the website for the DPO, you can find out more information. Sounds interesting. Closing comments, Tom?
I'd just like to thank
budget and the presentation you made to us this evening at our work session. I know it's a lot of work, and thank you very much. Appreciate it. Well done.
I want to thank Amanda tonight because, despite all of your apologies, you did a wonderful job this evening. And I know the next meeting you're hopefully going to feel more confident and feel better, and you won't apologize because you did a great job. Thank you. And just happy Thanksgiving, and everybody stay safe this week.
Word.
I'll echo the happy Thanksgiving and the putting of your reflectors and poles to help guide the sidewalk plows, and that's all I have. But again, thank you all for being on.
Jim, I mean, sorry.
Christine.
I want to thank Chief Waterman and City Manager Ireland for coming and presenting at my town hall. It was a little contentious with some of the questions. I also want to thank Nick Augustine and Jim Fodor for coming. They brought the coffee, I brought the cookies. So it was a long meeting, and we were there till 8:30. Yeah, and it was a good time hit by all, and they handled themselves wonderfully. So thank you very much. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. And again, thanks to the staff, Andrew, for the budget. That's a lot of work. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Jim?
I didn't bring any cookies or coffee, but I had both, so I did my fair share. Once again, to remind people to get the leaves, because I know that the snow coming and plowing is going to back up things and make it tough on the roads. That and in the winter months, take a look at your neighbors and make sure our elderly and so forth are being taken care of. That's about it.
I just want to echo everybody when I say thank you for coming in and presenting to us. Also want to thank staff for putting together the ambassador program page that we looked over. I think the concept and the idea is very exciting, and I'm excited to branch out with council and kind of divide and conquer.
And I'd just like to add, December 10th, the PCIC, Kingsville City Group Corporation, is having their annual Christmas light judging. Thank you, Brent, for putting that on your site. It's from 5:30 to 9 o'clock, and there'll be people driving around in your neighborhood with spotlights trying to get your regulated size address plaque. It's supposed to be 4 inches. So, again, that's...
No city inspector will be there.
No. But I'll be out there with them. But so, again, that's December 10th, which is a Monday. And I need a motion to go into an executive session.
I make a motion to go into executive session in accordance with or Article 21, ORC, sorry, Harris Projects. 121-228 to consider confidential information related to marketing plans, specific business strategy, production techniques, trade secrets, or personal financial statements of an action for economic development assistance, or to negotiate with other political subdivisions respecting requests for economic development assistance in accordance with Section 3735-67 of the revised code.
Thank you.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mrs. Jenkins?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Hare?
Yes, I'd like to stay in this room, so